welcome James McDonald, head of school, to open our dialogue.
Good afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to not only our students, but to our special guests here today. We are very, very lucky, both of us that are either you're a student here, maybe you're a parent, or maybe you're a teacher, but we're very lucky to be in a community like this, very privileged. And today, with Dr. ElBaradei here, a Nobel Peace Prize winner, is another reminder of that. And we're going to do a formal introduction in just a second, but I did want to say and thank the International Peace Foundation for its partnership in making this Bridges Dialogue come together. The opportunity that you have in front of us today wouldn't happen without a lot of different volunteers who are working very hard to promote peace around the world. And you know, one thing that's really exciting about my job, about the other teachers here at the school, is that we know that by working with you as students, we might be able to change the world a little bit, because we know we can help give you an education that might allow you to change the world a little bit. And as you know, NIST was founded by UN parents many years ago, and the idea was that we want to create a more peaceful world. So I think the message today is just going to reinforce that, and we're really proud and honored to have Dr. ElBaradei here. So we're going to do a formal introduction, and thank you, Tanya, for emceeing today.
We are very lucky today to welcome Dr. Mohamed ElBaradei. Throughout our human journey, we have been trying in vain to find ways and means to live together in peace and dignity. Instead, our world continues to be marred by inequality and insecurity. Violence and coercion continue to be the primary means to try to settle our differences. An obscene economic and social inequality continues to be our default setting. Dr. ElBaradei will discuss the danger of maintaining the status quo in our increasingly globalized world and the urgent steps that need to be taken to avoid sleepwalking into self-destruction. Me being a Ukrainian citizen and in an international school means that I'm very acutely aware of the need to find peaceful solutions to regional or global conflicts. I'm sure like me and you, will all be extremely interested in hearing Dr. ElBaradei's story and thoughts. Can I please welcome Dr. Mohamed ElBaradei to the stage?
McDonald, Tanya, it's a pleasure to be with you here, guys. And what I want to do is just have a brief introduction and then get into a conversation with you. I don't claim at all to have the solution to all the problem we have, but I know we have a lot of problems on our hands. And I know you are going to live with these problems. And I know it is then up to you whether you are going to make the world a more safer and a more humane world. I don't need to tell you much about the inequality of our world. I'm sure you read that all the time. Some of you travel around and you see the obscene inequality. And these, you know, again, I give you a couple of numbers. You know, there's 1% of the world who are going to own next year 50% of the global assets. 1%. There's 80 people whom you can put in one bus who owns more than 3.5 billion people. Even in the US, you know, where everybody is proud of the democracy, the 1% now, the top 1% in the US, owns as much as 99%. Is that sustainable? That's the first question I put you. And these are not just numbers, because when you have 2.8 billion people, you do not expect that these people would be chirpy, would have hope, would have dreams. And their life is condemned from day one. They have no access to education, that kind of quality education you are privileged, lucky to have. They have no access to health care, they have no access to housing, they have no, many of them, 900 million of them, do not have enough food night. So these are just some numbers, and I can rattle you a lot of other numbers to show how unequal the world has become. And this is not just numbers, but these are lives. These are people who are losing hope, who are losing dreams, who feel humiliated, who feel lack of dignity. This is one of the extremist guys trying to express anger. And we have a lot of anger. Again, when you see now extremism going around everywhere, well, and all we talk about is that we need to use force to squash ISIL, to squash Al-Qaeda, to squash whatever other groups are coming. But the more difficult, or not so difficult, question is to ask, why has they turned out that way? You know, what kind of environment that created this kind of human beings? Why do you have in the same world an environment that gets us people like Mother Teresa, and at the same time get us people who are ready to explode themselves? This is the most difficult question. And not so difficult because we are not, it's difficult because we are not addressing it. It's not difficult because we know the answer. The answer that these people are yearning for dignity and they want to be treated as human beings. So this is a question you should keep on your mind as you are going along. You can have your career. You will be fantastic doctors and engineers and IT specialists. But if that's enough, or do you want also to live in an environment when you feel safe, when you feel secure, when you feel your conscience is at peace? Because you don't look around on television, and now we know how connected we have become. And you see all this agony and wars and killing and atrocities and barbarism, all this happening. And we are, it's not, again, as I keep mentioning, it's no longer an ethical question alone. It's not a link, because it's becoming a question of survival. If you look at, you know, the kind of the bombing in Madrid, the killing in Paris, there is no place, no place in the world where you will be quarantine. So this is an issue of ethical issue, of course, but it's also an issue of survival. If we want to be able to save ourselves from ourselves, we need to have a change of mindset, and we need to have a kind of different values we live by. That's one. Secondly, of course, we have, you know, an amazing ability to stereotype and dehumanize even each other. If you look at the wars going on around the world, everywhere, and it doesn't stop. I mean, our human history, of course, is a history of wars interrupted by short spells of peace throughout recorded history. And you can read, I'm sure you have read, so 30 years war, 80 years war, First World War, Second World War, Peloponnesian War. I mean, and this, you know, we spent, or we, hundreds of millions of lives lost in vain. Some of the countries who were even fighting during some of these wars no longer exist. But we need, again, to ask that question. Why do we need to fight each other? Can't we find a better way to resolve our differences? It's like in any family, in a school, at home, we have differences, but we don't go and kill each other. We find a way to talk to each other and find a way to reach a compromise. Why can't we do that in the global village we live in. Third issue, of course, is on one hand, the world is becoming so globalized, you know, that no one country, no matter how powerful it is, can resolve the issues at hand. If you look at climate change, if you look at arms control, if you look at communicable diseases, you know, these are all issues that require closer global cooperation. And yet, we are continuing to work business as usual, continue to work with the same institutions that were created in 1945, the UN system and other organizations that were created after the Second World War. But they are no longer relevant. I mean, they are not able to address these issues, A, because they don't have the resources or the authority. So they are in many ways dysfunctional, as we've seen as a prime example in the Security Council, where you see the international community wringing its hands, you know, while people keep dying, innocent civilians keep dying. A recent example, for example, in Syria, when 200,000 people died in the last 3 years. 3 million refugees are living in squalor, and yet nothing was done because government continued to apply a myopic short-term national policies that are totally inadequate to deal with long-term global issues that require global cooperation. So we have, and maybe another problem is weaponry. Since the Second World War, we invented these nuclear weapons and other weapons of mass destruction, chemical weapons, biological weapons. We know that nuclear weapons, you know, one weapon exploded, either accidentally or intentionally or through computer design, could be the beginning of our self-destruction. And yet, 25 years after the end of the Cold War, we continue to have 16,000 nuclear warheads. 2,000 of them are on high status alert, meaning that the president of the US or of Russia would have something like half an hour or an hour to respond to a reported nuclear attack, which could very much be a computer error. So, on the one hand, we live in a world that is divided between us and them, us, the rich and the wealthy, them, the poor and disenfranchised. We live in a world that continue to rely primarily for security on weapons that, if ever used, could lead to our self-destruction. Recently, I was giving a lecture at Robert McNamara Memorial Lecture, who was Secretary of Defense at the US, and he became later on, you know, he's active in Vietnam, and became later on a strong advocate of nuclear disarmament. And he said human fallibility means that nations will be destroyed. Bill Perry, who was the Secretary of Defense, so mentioned again recently that we manage to survive by good luck and not by good design, that nuclear weapons have not been used. These are people who came from the heart of the Cold War, who understand fully the implication of living with nuclear weapons. But yet, despite Barack Obama's commitment a few years ago at Prague, you know, for a world free from nuclear weapons, we haven't really moved very much. Neither is the Russian, neither is the other. We have 9 nuclear weapon states. 95%, of course, of the weapons are in the US and Russia. But they are also asking everybody else not to develop nuclear weapons. In anticipation, in commitment, in return of a commitment they made to move toward nuclear disarmament. But they made that commitment in 1990, 70. And 45 years ago, with 16,000 nuclear weapons, well, obviously that commitment rings hollow. Obviously a commitment that was not made in good faith. So the weaponry we have is could lead to our destruction. The obscene inequality we have is leading to a more militant, polarized societies and extremism in the most horrible way. And while in certain parts of the world, we live toward globalization, integration. If you look at Europe right now, we have 27 members of the European Union, where you can travel without visas, and there's a genuine process of integration, which is great to match the corresponding globalization we see, you know, where the city is becoming pretty much the state. But at the other time, same in parallel, we see disintegration, lots of disintegration. I mean, when you look at some of the countries in the Middle East or in East Asia, I mean, you look, people are losing identity with the state, and therefore they are running back to their own tribal identity, religious identity, color identity. And again, it's not in any way coherent, it's not in any way symmetric, that on the one hand we are globalizing, on the other hand we are fragmentizing. On the one hand we are getting amazing technology, the way we connect with each other, you know, the advances in biology, advances in nuclear physics, but at the same time we are continue to rely on our security, on who has the bigger stick, essentially, who has the bigger stick. And so if you put these together, if you look around you, you understand quickly that this is not a sustainable global order. And if you want to have a peaceful world, when every one of you would be entitled to his or her human dignity, meaning enough food on the table, health care, freedom of expression, freedom of belief, well, you better do something about it. Because how do you do something about it? Government are not doing anything about it. Because unfortunately, politicians are thinking short-term, are thinking 2 years, 4 years term, how that would impact on my election prospects or my party's prospects. Do you need to get involved? Sure, you need to get involved. Because unless you get involved, the world you will inherit will be more of the same, if not even more dangerous. How do you get involved? You get involved through primarily educating yourself to understand the issues and understand there's a world outside the school, there's a world outside the gated communities you live in, there's a world outside the privileged life we have, we all have, and understand that we need to look at that, and we need to change it. We need to change it, as I said, for ethical and practical reasons, survivors. And we need to tell our politicians that we do not want to live in a world when we can wake up in the morning and discover that half of the world has been destroyed. And we want international institutions that are fit to be able to deal with global governments. So we save our environment. So we save our species. So we make sure that we have a fair trade rules. So we make sure that we have enough healthcare affordable to everybody. Do we have money for that? Absolutely. I mean, anybody who will tell you that we don't have money is fooling you. Because, again, I give you one number. We're spending $1.7 trillion last year on armament. $1.7 trillion. Jim Morris, who used to be the head of the World Food Program, told me once that if he gets 1% of that, 1%, nobody of the 900 million people would go to bed hungry. yet he doesn't get them. If you look a couple of weeks ago, Guterres, you know, who is the head of the UN, UN refugee agencies, is begging, almost begging, and that's the story of the whole UN everywhere, begging for money, you know, to save lives. He is begging for $8 billion, and that's again less than maybe 0.5% of what we spend on army, to deal with the increasing flux of refugees. You know. And he said he only has 50% of the money. If that's fair, if that's rational, that's not. So the money is absolutely available. It is not a question of money. It's a question of mindset. Do we need to continue to live within our little cocoons, thinking that we are secure, that we are safe, that we have a good life? Or do we need to look at the big picture and understand that this situation is not sustainable by any means? And if I want to have, you want to have a future, a safe future, a humane future, a compassionate future, we need to have a different set of values, primarily based on human solidarity, that I look at every one of you, everyone in the world, black, white, red, speak Sinhalese or Arabic or, you know, black or ethnic, you know, have an ethnic difference. I mean, at the end, are these really, do these things matter? Or are we all the same human beings? React to the same stimuli and want the same things. You, of course, realize it here in this international school. Because you are from how many nationalities here? 50? 50 nationalities. So I assume from every part of the world. You understand that living together, irrespective of different religion, of different, you know, colors, backgrounds, language, it doesn't make a hoot of a difference, because what you have together, what we all have together, is much more, much, much more than we think separates us. And we need to focus on that, on what really we have in common. And understand that all what we think about, the superficial differences to which we have gone through millennia, are absolutely superficial. It's a question, it's not a question of money, it's not a question of drastic change, it's a question of change of mindset. Mindset to understand, particularly now, in the 21st century with all this globalization, that we are the same one human family. And we are either going to move forward together, or we are going to sink together. That is, I think, something you need to keep in mind. And don't listen to all the, you know, hubris you get in the newspaper about different politics, about demonizing other countries. All these issues, people need to sit together and make sure that they find a solution that does not involve using force. Make sure that the people in need do not have to go around begging or fighting or exploding other places to get the basic needs. We need to treat them as human beings, and we are not. And if we are not treating them as human beings, we should not be surprised that they should not act. This might sound a bit depressing, but it's not meant to be. It's meant just to put the facts before you. I mean, I used to be more optimistic in this picture, but this picture was taken while I was dealing with the Iraq situation, with the Iran situation, and with sitting in a hot seat, and I know any decision I made could make a difference between war and peace. And unfortunately, in certain cases, we succeeded. In other cases, like Iraq, we failed. We failed because to convince people to act in good faith. And again, Iraq is a good example. A war that has been launched on the basis of falsehood 10 years, 12 years ago. Look at Iraq today. Is it any better? These are, I mean, again, just example to show that it is not through use of force, it's not flexing muscles. It is reaching out to each other. It is showing respect to each other. It is understanding where each other is coming from, that we can, as I said, save ourselves from ourselves. I'll stop here and I'll be happy to answer any question you have, if I can. Ask a question I could answer.
Hi, my name is James. And why do you think that we as humans like to hold ourselves in a position of power rather than sharing it with others? And do you think this is a part of human nature? And if we have to change it, do we as humans change ourselves?
I mean, when you talk about position of power, is anybody really in a position of power right now? Can you prevail? I mean, you ask, put the question different. Can you prevail on your own? I mean, take the most powerful country, the US. Can it prevail on its own? I mean, with all the major political crises going around the world, you need, either political conflict or even environmental issues or Ebola crisis. I mean, you need international cooperation. It is not whether human beings are born to kill each other. Well, that's a different question. I'm not sure it is. I'm sure it's just a question of there was a human evolution throughout history. Unfortunately, we haven't done much progress in that way. It has always been, if you look at the last 1,000 years, it has always been a question of the fight between the Pope and the Emperor, essentially. It's the religious power, which is, again, some form of power, and the physical power, the Emperor. You call him a dictator, you call him an authoritarian system. Right? But this has been going on, lost in translation in all of that. Are the innocent civilians who get killed. You don't remember even, many of the causes of the wars I mentioned, I would mention. Nobody would. But yet, millions and millions of people. If this is the yin and yang of the human nature, I don't think so. That we have a good part and that we have an evil part. I think it's a question of education. I think it's a question of where our mindset is, situated. So I think it's, as I said, also that what I'm asking is that you will not do great sacrifice. Would it really make it painful for the global community to spend 1% of what they spent on armament on feeding the hungry? Would it, make a difference for them if they spent another 1%? So the millions of people who die out of HIV, AIDS, and malaria in Africa would have been survived with us today. They died because they have no access. They can't afford the medication. These are not great sacrifices. Are we very happy to, go around like a peacock talking about national sovereignty while national sovereignty is taking us nowhere? How is national sovereignty going to save our environment? How is national sovereignty going to, protect us from a nuclear holocaust? How is national sovereignty going to help us with organized crime, drug trading? I mean, in all these issues, there is not one single country, there is not one single group who is able to do it on your own. We tried over the centuries, since the Kurdish, we tried since a Greek city-state, then we went into empire, Then we went into national states with national sovereignty since the Peace of Westphalia. Now we are coming back in many ways into, again, more of a larger space. You see that in the European Union, you see it in ASEAN, you see it in the US. I mean, you see large space being created. But at the same time, we are being fragmented, and you see a lot of people losing identity with the state. And we have now like 192 members of the UN. You want that to fragment into 1,000? If we continue to go for self-determination of every ethnic group? Or do you want to say, it really doesn't matter. You know, we need a functioning social unit that could provide law and order and could provide security for the individual? Does it really matter, you know, if Catalan is part of Spain or Basque is part of Spain, or, you know, or they become a different? They obviously, in my view, better off in a larger space. You know, the synergy will provide them much better. But to do that, the state has to continue to nurture the identity with the state. And people, once people lose that identity with the state, then you get into this chaotic, you know, fragmentation. So it is not, as I said, it is not that we have to change our nature. It is we try maybe to look at a little bit the big picture and understand, is that situation sustainable today? When you have an organization like ISIS, who is controlling, you know, completely, you know, a terrorist group, controlling a space as much as Switzerland. When you have Europe now going through some sort of mini war in Ukraine, I mean, nobody ever thought that. So the writing is in the wall that situation, that environment, these rules are not going to last very long. And we do not need to wait until a major disaster falls upon us. We always, the international community, act on the basis of shock treatment, that we wait until something horrible happens and then we rush to say. So, for example, you had the 9/11 attack, all of a sudden we discover something called nuclear security, that we need to, you know, protect radioactive material. You know, we discovered that Iraq was developing a nuclear weapon. All of a sudden, we discovered that we need to have a better inspection system. But that's not the way we should act. We should have some vision, some prevention. You know, we should rely on prevention. And again, I come back to say it is not that I want people to give power, or do I want people to change their nature. And you can question about what is really power? What is power? And, you know, can you have power alone? Is power a zero-sum game? It's obviously not a zero-sum. It is, you know, power has to be shared, whatever power. But power to me is the power of the individual to live the life she or he wants to live. I mean, power is not for the state. State is an abstract. The power has to reside with the people. And that's actually what democracy is all about. That you are, the people are they have the residual authority, you know, to create government and to create the form of an institution that enables them, you know, to live in peace and dignity.
Hey, my name is Farid. This kind of relates to James's question. When you were talking about war, I was thinking that, you know, the reason that the wealth distribution is not equal is because we're animals, you know, and if there was like one food source and there were 10 people, the 10 people would fight to get to the food source because we're selfish and we want to survive ourselves. So do you think this is a reason for why wealth distribution around the world is unequal, or do you think there are other reasons? And I'd like to know your opinion on overpopulation and how that affects the distribution of wealth.
Which population?
Overpopulation.
Well, I'm not sure the wealth distribution is in such a bad shape because we are animals, because there is enough wealth for all the animals of us and more for everybody else. You know, I don't see that we have a shortage of resources. It's just a question that we are more and more actually developing this bunker mentality, retrenched mentality, that we are do not want to see the people around us. So we see the small tribe we live in, and we do not want to see the world around us. But even within the country, within countries, I mean, that is a result of absence of a fair tax system, which again, money has been able to influence legislation, so legislation would favor the rich. It's a perpetual cycle. As I said, when you end up in the US now, the gap is widening. Well, it's not because of lack of resources. It's because that you have a tax law system that does not lead to a more fair distribution of wealth. This French economist Piketty, who is now famous for basically talking about poverty and about wealth and distribution of wealth, think that if we continue the same way, the gap will be widened. He has come with some proposal that the global wealth tax or what have you. But I think a lot of economists agree with him that things are not going to change if we continue business as usual. But it is not, as I said, it is not that you are asking people to make great sacrifice. When you look at the list of billionaires, when people have $70-80 billion, does it really make a difference whether you have $60 billion or $5 billion or $10 billion? I mean, these are accounts in the banks. But it means also that other people are not having the basic minimum to be able to have a decent life.
Hi. So I wanted to ask a question on your opinion on the Jordanian response to ISIS.
What do you mean, response? Attacking ISIS, you mean?
Yeah.
Well, I think, unfortunately, ISIS has been such a horrible manifestation of the worst that you could have in human nature, if you call that human nature. So the short term that you have to use force. I mean, what do you do with people like Al Qaeda or ISIL? But that is a short term. As long as you understand that's a short term, and that you have to completely change the environment, so these people would lose credibility. So these people will become back into the, the mainstream. The solution is primarily a socio-economic political solution, long term. Short term, You have to use force. What else can you do?
Hi, my name is Kengo. You've talked a lot about education, how it could impact people and maybe change them. But what do you think about the human nature and how maybe it conflicts with the education, the new education that could be spread, and how which would you think would win over, the education to try to help the world or the selfish nature of human beings as animals, as Reed said?
I think, I'm not sure it is selfishness as much as it's a question of getting the wrong education. If you understand through an education process, if you first get knowledge, talking to Jim, understand the kind of parameters I'm talking about. If you then understand that you can fix it, then I'm not sure that it would be difficult to fix. But we are, as I said, we are building walls between ourselves. We are developing this sense of otherness while we continue to blab about togetherness. We are developing this sense of otherness, in fact, that they are there. They are not. They are not part of us. And that would be a tide that's going to, you know, sweep all of us. So education is key, but it's a question of curriculum. It's a question of what kind of education, and it's a question of knowledge. And right now, I see no reason why we should not be able to provide that. I mean, of course, quality education, but how many people get quality education? And how many part of the world the education is absolutely non-existent? So if you want to change the world, you need to change the education system, but you also want to change the knowledge. I think Mortimer Adler, who once said that 90% of what you learn is you learn after you graduate. That is, you need to continue to educate yourself. And you need the state, the community, you need to make sure that education knowledge is available all the time. Available in a way to give people facts. And I think if people have the facts, I'm not sure that there will be a dichotomy between being selfish and helping others. If you are in your immediate family, you are not, hopefully, selfish. You would not leave one of your immediate family who is dying of hunger or of disease. And what I'm basically saying is that you need to extend your concept of family from your immediate family, from your citizenship, to the rest of the world, the people in need. That is a question, in my view, of education, and a question of understanding the implication of not doing that.
Yeah. So you kept mentioning that we should save the others, but how exactly can we save others? How exactly can we save others?
How we can save our world? Well, we can save it in many ways. We can save it in making sure that we try to solve our differences without fighting, without resorting to force. We can save our environment by working together to make sure that we have a green policy, cutting climate change, the corrosive impact of CO2s. We can save our world by having an environment where everyone has his or her human dignity, which you can call it democracy, but system when you are empowering people. You can save our world, as I said, by having institutions that are capable of dealing with the issues that lay on our footsteps, and we are not yet capable of dealing with it. So there are different ways of saving our world, but everyone has to do his or her own bit, even small as it is. Everyone has to feel responsible. There is a social, there is an individual responsibility. Every one of us has to be held accountable. Jean-Paul Sartre mentioned that, talked about the individual responsibility. And I think that's true. We cannot just say, it's a government, it's a leader. Every one of us has some responsibility, which he has to exercise.
Good afternoon. My name is Hannah. And as I'm sure you're aware, the UN Millennium Development Goals are set to be reached within the next year. However, this seems increasingly improbable. My question to you is, given full support globally, what kind of time frame do you think we'd be looking at before change occurs and these issues begin to be solved?
Well, Hannah, I know that 10 years or 15 years ago when this Millennium Development Goal was adopted, that they are not going to be implemented. Because it's one thing, to talk the talk, it's another to walk the walk. I mean, it's easy to say we are going to cut poverty in half by 2015 or what have you. And it's another issue to put the money where what is needed. I remember, I think like 30 years ago, the rich developed countries committed themselves to provide 0.7% of their GDP to development assistance. That was over 30 years ago. The countries are respecting that commitment are only 4 or 5. It's all the Nordic countries. The US, for example, is paying 0.1% of the GDP to development assistance. So it's a question of are we serious about the commitment? I mentioned again the commitment about nuclear disarmament. You know, it's easy to say, I am committed to do this and that and the other. But it's another issue to act on it and to show good faith implementation.
Hi, my name is Erdong. Just going back to the topic of power and the distribution of power, what are some of your thoughts on China's claim over surrounding territories such as the islands in the Philippines, the Senkaku or Diaoyu Islands, and even Taiwan?
I frankly don't care much about this territorial disputes. I care much about, you know, people empowerment, about people having enough to eat. What difference does it make who has control over what? You know, and could it, you know, if you have the good intention, it could be joint control, it could be, you know, there's so many ways to split the cake if you are serious about it. You know, but to continue to talk about this is mine, you know, and I'm not going to share it with others, you know, that's fine. You know, but how that impact on humans, how that impact on civilians, that's what really makes the difference for me. Is any of these disputes looking at it from the perspective on the impact of the welfare on the people? I don't think so. I mean, it's all, you know, sovereignty, power game. You know, this is mine, you know, because basically I don't like the other, so I would like to claim this one. Well, that's how wars started. That's how wars launched. That's how war ends. And everybody at the end loses, because I never seen any war that at the end get anybody to win. I mean, you can win even temporarily, but unless the two sides feel that they are being fairly treated, this is then you are putting the seeds of another war.
Thank you so much for answering all of our questions. And can I please invite Mr. McDonald?
Well, those were quite the questions and quite the talk. There were quite a bit of human nature and global events and a whole lot of other topics. And I tell you, as an educator and as a person, it's pretty inspiring because it all comes down to how we treat each other. And you know, when you're in school and you got all these friendships you're navigating, you know what we're talking about when we're talking about global events or just all of that on a bigger scale. Really, you get into an argument with your friend, how are you going to work it out? These are things that countries have to deal with as well. And you know, we say all this and you guys are 16, 17 years old. I promise you, I absolutely promise you, 20, 30, 40 years from now, some of you are going to be in real positions of power where these basic concepts are just so important for a lot of people. So I hope that some of this has inspired you today. I certainly found it fascinating, and I was reminded again on just how privileged we are to be in a community such as this. Dr. ElBaradei, thank you very much. Right now, we're just going to move up top for a little photo. By the way, I think those are some of the first questions that you've been posed on this side of the ocean. You were at another school, but before that, you were speaking for the last 3 months at two other schools in Boston, MIT and Harvard. And so I think the questions that we had today from our students, did they do pretty well, considering? Yeah, that's a good smile. So well done, everybody. Yeah. Okay, we're going to go for a photo.